Welcome to ePathshala PG courses on computer science. The course is about web technology and we are going to see the fourth module about the markup languages. The objective of the module, we'll know about all the markup languages, and the module also provide an introduction about the HTML, and we'll also see the basic tags that works in an HTML like hyperlinks, tables, formatting, heading, paragraphs, etc. And before we go into the markup languages, let us know about some of the terminologies like what is a web server, website, web page, home page, etc. What is a web server? We have seen lot of things in the previous modules. It's a system on the internet containing one or more website. What is a website? It's a collection of one or more web pages. We can also create our own websites. So it's a collection of web pages. What is a web page? It's a single disk file with a single file name. And what is a home page? It's the first page in website. So now this module is about how to develop websites and how to develop web pages. So we need to know what is a web server. It contains all the websites, the information about the web pages. It contains about the information collection of websites. It contains the information of web pages. And we need to know what is a home page. It's the first page in website. And we have seen lot of things about how an email works, how an instant messaging works, how an web works, what is a protocol in order to make the web works, how to transfer information in the internet, everything. Okay. Now we'll see that how these information are stored in a web, in a world wide web. So the world wide web has got informations that are stored in the form of web pages. Normally these web pages are in HTML format. And the web pages are stored in the computers, and we call those computers that has information as web servers. So in the web server file system, we have the information of the web pages. The computer or the system, the one that is reading the pages, is called the web client, and normally these informations are read through a web browser. That's a software sitting in the client side. And most common browsers we use is an Internet Explorer or a Firefox. The web server normally waits for the request from the web client over the internet. Any of the web server, you will know that we have already listed in the previous module. It's an IIS server, it's an Internet Information Server, or an Apache server, Tomcat server, and Java Sun server. There are a lot of web servers out there. So here we need to make our web works, a web browser. We get into different terminologies like web browser, web server, and then web informations are available in an HTML format, all these things. Now, who defines this web standards? The web standards are not defined by Microsoft or any other browser companies. They are defined by a consortium called a World Wide Web Consortium. This, in short, we call it as W3C. The specifications form the web standards. So any of the markup languages are approved or made as a standard by this consortium, that is the W3C consortium. So HTML, CSS, there are several standards available to develop web pages, HTML, CSS, XML, XHTML, and so on. We'll see one by one here. And it's an important quote from W3C. The goal of W3C is to provide an universal access, which means that to make the web accessible to all technologies, to all people all over the world through an internet, and make the information to us, make it usefully for all the users by creating a semantic web. So we need to have a software environment that permits every user to make the best use of the resources available on the web. And then whatever web we use through the internet should be a place of trust. So they call it as a web of trust. This is to guide why the third goal is to have the information legally, commercially, and so considering all the social issues raised by the technologies. And the history of the markup languages. How does this markup languages come into existence? When you start developing a worldwide web, we know that all the informations are available as web pages. And in order to create a web page, we need a language like markup languages. Markup languages are not like programming languages. They are like presentation languages. What is the meaning of markup? So it actually provides instructions for a document, which means that it's like annotating a document. Markup means that, markuping means that annotating a document. So if you annotate a document, it's like instructions that are available on a manuscript to instruct or to instruct the software or the browser to instruct the browser to display how the document should be presented in it form. So we need to have markup languages, so only the web pages are created in a like a simple text file, but once it is created, the presentation style is given by the markup languages. So in the early 90s, we have a language called generalized markup language. So in simple, it has tags like this. But later, since the 1980s, that comes with the standard generalized markup language, SGML. But it was too complex and it was used only by publishers and government. And an instance of SGML was created, that is called as the HTML. It was by Berner. The person developed this language, HTML. It's an hypertext markup language. So it has basic tags, and this HTML evolved nowadays to the different versions of it. We'll see in the next slide. Currently in the market, we also have a markup language called an XML, extensible markup language. So this markup language is not developed to replace HTML. So to improve HTML, we had another markup language called XHTML. This would actually provide a better data description of the document. So we'll see that how these technologies has evolved, SGML, HTML and XML. So SGML was developed as a meta language, SGML was simplified as an XML. From SGML, we can see that there is a defined markup language called HTML. So it means that SGML was too complex and HTML was so simple to use to develop any web page. So an instance of SGML is an HTML. And using this HTML, we are creating web pages. Like SGML, there is another meta language that has been developed recently called an XML. Once an XML comes into existence, and in order to improve this HTML, we get into another markup language called XHTML. And now this XML has got metadata, it stores metadata like XML definitions, and then whatever that is created using this XML or called as XML documents, that could be parsed and the informations can be retrieved. So it's the relationship between how this SGML evolved into HTML and it's evolved into XML and so on. So let us see what is an HTML. HTML is an hypertext markup language. It's a set of markup symbols. Normally you call it as codes or you call it as tags or elements that is inserted in a text file to instruct how to display in a browser, web browser. So you can, in a text file, you can also have text, images, sound, video files, etc. But what format, how to display everything would be provided by this markup language. And it is, as I told you earlier, it is not a programming language and it cannot be used for doing any of the computations. So the markup, the individual markup codes that are inserted in the text files, people refer to them as tags or elements. And we can see that how this HTML has evolved as a standard. Initially, you had HTML1, as I told, it's like a person, Berners-Lee, who has developed this HTML. It's an instance of SGML. It's very basic and it has limited integration of multimedia. So you cannot use multimedia. The basic tags are available in HTML1. Then comes a standard called HTML2.0. It was actually IETF was trying with HTML2.0. It tries to standardize these with other features. But W3C came into picture and these people attempts to standardize HTML 3.2, made it as a standard, but it doesn't add newer technologies like Java applets and streaming video. And then we had HTML 4.0. This is the current standard, but we are moving towards XHTML. And then we had, after HTML 4.0, we had XHTML 1.0. It was in 2000. And this actually HTML, why you come with an XHTML, extreme HTML, they call it as extreme HTML or extensible HTML. This is actually HTML is modified to conform to XML standard, that's called as the XHTML. And then standardizing this as XHTML 1.1. And then after XHTML 1.1, people went in standardizing HTML5. This actually was developed in order to make it backward compatible with the older versions of HTML. So now HTML5 is referred to as a living language. So people, one would be interested in learning XHTML or HTML5, and then an XML. It's a different, it's a meta language. XML is a meta language and HTML is actually a presentation language. So now we can see that what is a brief introduction about all these markup languages. XML is an extensible markup language. X stands for extensible. It provides a standard way to represent information so as to allow information to be stored and interchanged among any internet connected devices. The meaning is that this XML is for transferring information, for storing information and transferring information. And it is not a markup language. As I told you, it is not a markup language. It is not for presenting or displaying the content. It is for describing the content of the describing the content of the web page. So it's a describing language, not like you cannot say that it's for displaying any information on the web page. HTML in turn is an it actually has predefined presentation semantics. HTML has got a inbuilt presentation semantics. Mainly for the purpose of it is to display information, present information in a web browser in a way the user needs it. But XML is a language for, is a markup language for storing and transferring information, and it's more for describing information. And browsers normally use XML parsers to extract the information from the XML documents. And what is an XHTML? It's an extensible hypertext markup language, and it's a reformulation of HTML4. So as we have seen in the history, after HTML4 we get into XHTML. So it's a way of making XML documents that look and act like HTML documents. So once we get the flavor of XML, we try to put the flavor of XML with HTML. XML has got several strict rules. All these strict rules has been implemented in HTML, and we call it as XHTML. This actually helps us to strengthen the structure and the syntax of our markup language. And there is another markup language people would like, wireless markup language. They are formally called as handheld devices markup language. This markup language is for displaying web pages in a mobile device, any handheld devices, and it's a part of the protocol called a WAP, that is a wireless application protocol. So this wireless markup language WML is a language for displaying web pages in a mobile device. And now comes, people would have heard about cascading style sheets. All these are the technologies that comes together with the markup languages. So what is the CSS? This actually provides a powerful and flexible way to control the details of web documents. It actually adds styles to the web documents. And why you call it as cascading? Because it can be defined at different levels. You can have a CSS implemented as inline, or it can be at a document level, or it can be an external level. So once you have an HTML file, HTML document, HTML document has got some predefined tags. So once you have an HTML document, in order to add styles to your HTML, more styles to your HTML document, you need to have this style sheets. These style sheets can be either inbuilt in your HTML document, that is called as an inline, or it can be in a document level. For multiple pages, you can have a single CSS file which will provide the common style to all the multiple web pages. Or you can have an external style sheet that can be called within this HTML document to present this document. And what is a DHTML? DHTML, in other words, you call it as a dynamic HTML. So once you have known about what is HTML, what is CSS, and you also know that there could be some scripts that can be written in the client side and the server side, as we have seen in the earlier modules, this DHTML is a combination of the three things like HTML, style sheets and scripts. So if you want to describe a web document that built from HTML, style sheet and scripts, then you call it as a DHTML. This DHTML is mainly for providing the web pages dynamically to the user, which means that to make the web pages interact with the user through the browser. So when you want any form that is displayed to the client, if it has to interact with the client without going to the server, then you need to design that web page using a DHTML. So you add some scripts to the web page that runs in the client side, client web browser, and style sheets also added, this called as an DHTML. So the three main parts of a DHTML is positioning, style modifications, and then event handling, which is what you call it as, why you call it as an DHTML. So it relies on the browser, depends on the browser that is displaying and manipulating the web page. So if you write a DHTML script that would can run in one browser would not run in another browser, depends on the browser. So now let us brief some of the client side and server side technologies. Getting into the client side technologies, you can see that HTML, this is for creating the web pages, XML is for creating XML documents. We have seen about the cascading style sheets that can add styles to these web pages. Some of the scripting languages that can be implemented in the client side like JavaScript, VBScript, Java applets, ActiveX controls, plugins and helpers applications, these are all events that can run in the client side. In the server side, you can see that there are technologies like CGI, Perl, PHP, ColdFusion, so on. And some of these scripting languages like server side JavaScript is there, ASP, JSP, Java Servlets, ISAPI, NSAPI programs. So, we will see in detail in the forthcoming modules. So, now we are started with the client side markup languages called and HTML. So, getting into the details of HTML. We will see what is a HTML document first. So, HTML documents are simple text documents. We use simple ASCII text files and we will save it as .html or .htm. And we create these HTML documents using a notepad or text edit if you are using a Mac OS. And we can also use HTML editors. There are editors like this. Say for example, there are editors like Dreamweaver, FrontPage, GoLib, but it is not advisable to use editors. You will not know that how it works. It gives its own tags and adds many codes which you will not understand what's happening. So better to have a notepad and type your own tags to make it presentable to you. So HTML editors are also called as what you see is what you get. And now coming to what is the structure of an HTML document. The HTML document contains text and then it contains the whole text, and it uses the file extension like .html or .hm, and then the document contains tags which are also called as elements, and to provide more information about these elements or to have the behavior how the element should behave, we can also have attributes. So, this embedded tags provide instruction for the structure and appearance of the content. This HTML document is divided into two parts like head and body. The head contains information about the document. So, it contains the title of the page which normally appears at the top of the browser window, the meta tags which is used to describe the content used by nor only by search engines. When you search for information, it searches this meta tags to fetch whether this information is relevant for that search content. And then it also, this head part section also contains the script code, the JavaScript and the style sheets, the generally request statements in the document head. The body part contains the actual content of the document. This is the part that will be displayed in the browser window. The head is not displayed, the body part is what displayed. So, you can see a sample HTML document. It starts with a tag. Every tag has an ankle bracket, an open ankle bracket and a closing ankle bracket. So, it starts with a tag like HTML and there is a closing tag for HTML. And there are two sections for a HTML document, the head section and the body section. And the head tag is opened and then closed. You can see that a closed tag will have an ankle bracket and there is a slash. And in the head tag, there is a title of the web page. And the body tag, you have the content of the document. So, what about HTML tags? All HTML tags are made of a tag name, as I have told you now. And they are sometimes followed by a list of attributes. It's optional. And these tags will appear between the ankle brackets we have seen earlier. And nothing within the brackets will be displayed by the browser unless it is incorrectly written. If you don't close the bracket, then that would appear as a text in your browser window. Attributes are properties that gives the behavior of this, that actually says the behavior of this tag, that extend or refine the tags functions. Now we can see the basic syntax. Most but not all. So, all the tags, most of the tags in HTML have a start tag and an end tag. We can see that a start tag is embedded within two ankle brackets. A closing tag is embedded within ankle bracket, but you can see that there is a slash. So, H1 is a tag, predefined tag in HTML. It's heading 1, size heading 1, and the content that is displayed is hello world. And the basic document structure has got a header and the body. Header has the information about the page, and the body has got the actual content of the page, and any document starts with the HTML tag and ends with the HTML. There are some standalone tags which do not use an end tag. So, certain tags like image, img to display an image, and break, line break, horizontal rule, header, not header, horizontal rule, these are the some, there are some standalone tags which do not have an closing tag. These problems actually were overcome in XHTML. In HTML, XHTML is a markup language that is a standard of HTML, and it conforms to the XML rules. So, in XML, for every open tag, there should be a closed tag. So, this standalone tags are not available in XHTML. Now, we can see that in tags, HTML tags, you can have attributes. So, there is a tag called body tag, and there are attributes like bg color equal to some value, text is another attribute equal to some value, link is another attribute equal to some value, and v link, visitor link, a link equal to black. So, in order to describe more on the tag, we can have attributes. So, many of the tags have many such attributes. Every attribute will have a name, following it you will have an equal to sign, and then you will have the value, and this value is given within double quotes. And these values are limited to 1024 characters in length. Now, you can see that certain things are ignored by the browser. Say for example, if you have used tabs or multiple spaces, this is all normally ignored and it appears as a single space. Suppose you have typed like this hello and then a blank and a line spaces, multiple spaces, and then in the next line if you are typing as how are you, then the browser will ignore the blanks and give the new line and will display as a single line of text. And now going into the basic tags like p tag, p is a paragraph tag and br is a break tag. So, break will break that line and will start in a new line. So, the next thing will come in the following a break tag will come in the next new line, will start with a new line. Paragraph tag will create more space than a break tag, which means that when you use a paragraph tag, it gives a new line and then it goes to the next line. And HR tag is used to create a horizontal rule. And now, a paragraph tag leaves one empty line after the tag. Supposing if you use multiple P tags with no intervening text, then in that case, all those multiple texts would be taken as redundant by the browser and will display as a single paragraph tag. So, it leaves only one line. Now, the line break is giving a break is br. And this tag breaks the line and starts the text as a new line, at a new line. So, it will not add an empty line like a paragraph tag, and if you use multiple br tags, then that will display multiple line breaks. And with the horizontal rule HR tag, we can use attributes like width, which will give the width, the line would be of width. Three tag is displayed in a monospaced font, and then you can have a tag like em, it is an emphasis, normally the browser displays as italics. And there is like strong is similar like bold, your whatever text that is embedded within this strong is displayed as bold. And there is a tag like TT, teletype, and then this is like the text would be printed in a typewriter format. And making some citation, if you want to make some citation in the document, then you use a tag like cite, it represents a document citation, and normally it appears as italics. And there is thing like list. A list are used to organize items in the browser window, and you can create either an unordered list order or an ordered list. Unordered list would appear with bullets, and there is no particular order. Ordered list are appearing with numbers. Say for example, ordered list you create with a tag OL and unordered list you create with a tag UL. So, ordered list would be numbered as 1, 2, 3, unordered list can be numbered with bullets, and there is also other, you can also change in what type of bullet you wanted or how it should be numbered, etc. The basic syntax, you can see that unordered lists are created with a tag like UL, and within this opening and closing UL, you can see there is a tag like list item. LI means list item, UL means unordered list. So, banana and grape, here you can see that fruit appears the text as such, and banana and grape is bulleted, unordered the list items. And there are other attributes that can come with OL. The OL or UL, unordered list or the ordered list. You can see that the type can be, there is an attribute called type, and you can give a value like capital I or small I. This is for ordering it with Roman numerals. Capital A or small a, then it is
numbering with capital letters or small letters. And 1 means with default, that is the default, it is numbered as 1, it starts with 1, 2, 3. And when you use an unordered list, we can see that the bullets can be of disk pattern, or it can be round pattern, or it can be square pattern. The disk pattern is default used for the first level list, and for the second level list it uses a round bullet, and for the third level list it uses a square bullet. Now you can see that how you create an ordered list. As I told you, it is a tag like OL, open and closed within OL, and the items are listed like this. And you can see an example ordered list. There is an attribute like type. You can see that, as I told you, I. It starts, you need not start with A, it starts with I. And then you can see here, type is I, which means that the Roman, the small Roman I. And then the starts with 3 means the it is going to be the third. So this is an example of how it is numbered. List item 1, 2, and the third, you can see here, it is a paragraph tag is given, and the third starts with the third, 3, start equal to 3. So the Roman numeral starts with 3. So the third item, the list item, starts with 3. And there are also other list elements like definition list and definition terms. So you can use a tag like DL, DT, and you can list the definitions. So let us summarize. So we have looked at different markup languages, and we have started with the HTML, and we have explored the basic HTML tags like pre-formatting, the character formatting tags, and we have started with the list tags, and we have seen the rest of the things we will see in the next module. Thank you.